I so thankful, there's our word, so thankful that you chose to be with us today, both here in the room and online at home. Let's stand together. My name is Paul, and I have the privilege of doing worship with this awesome crew. This is where our hope is.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame.
Thank you. can be seated. Oh, thank you so much, guys. What an awesome way to start the morning. We know that Christ is our solid rock, and there's so much around us right now that feels like sinking sand. He is the one that we can hold on to, our anchor in the storm. My name is Christy. I work with Sunday services here at Magnify, and we are so glad that you are with us this morning. Whether you're tuning in online, you're visiting us in person for the first time, or you've been here for years, we are so grateful for your presence in this community where we can be faithful and present and known. Thank you for partnering with us. We are just so, so glad. If you have any questions during this time of what is happening here in our building, how you can connect with us online, please visit our website. There's a Connect With Us box way down at the bottom that you can click and fill out, and someone will get in touch with you. You can check out our Sunday Experience page and find out more about the ministries that are happening. But again, thank you for partnering with us. We know that your giving here shapes us, and that by giving, we are shaped through God. I want to introduce Ashley Eisenhoff this morning. As we go through the end of the year, we've been connecting with these stories of how giving has shaped us. And Ashley's got a great story that she wants to tell us.
So I was first drawn to this community because of the so many outreach programs and opportunities that we have here to use our passions and our gifts to serve God and to serve other people and just glorify His name in all we do. So since I've been coming here, I've gotten to be part of the Dramas here, which is an outreach. I've gotten to serve with Degage and Alpha Women's Center and Kids Food Basket and just so many fun things that is amazing to do and rare opportunities that we get to have. And something that also has impacted my life so much that I'm so grateful that all of these kids and teens and adults get to have is the trips. So what happens each trip I've been on is the band starts playing, everybody is powerfully praising our King, and all of a sudden the band stops playing and you just hear hundreds of voices praising our God and just thinking this is a glimpse of what it's going to be like when our King is on His throne. And it's so amazing and so powerful. And I know that this all couldn't be done without you guys giving everything that you do. And so I'm so grateful for this community and you guys. So thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing that with us, Ashley. Oh, wonderful. Well, thank you again for partnering with us. We are not going to pass a plate today. However, you can check it out on the screen or down on your lower thirds. There are the different ways that you can give to this place where your giving shapes people's lives and opens up these opportunities for teens to be on trips, for us to worship, for you to connect. Thank you for that. We're going to have Matt come up and share the word with us. Our service is going to look a little different this week, but he will talk to us about David and expecting the unexpected. And then we're going to move into a time of preparing our hearts for the Advent season. So we'll have an Advent reading, and the kids from the Kids of Magnify are going to come in and join us for that time. So thank you for being here. First, though, would you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father God, we are just so thankful for you. As we come out of this week of Thanksgiving, God, we just praise your name for who you are, our rock, our refuge, God, our anchor in the storm. We need you, God. Oh, do we need you. Thank you for your presence, for the peace that you give us that only you can give, and for what you're doing in this place and in our lives, Lord. We just ask for you to come alongside and make your presence known, Lord. There are so many in our body who are hurting, who have lost loved ones, God, who are separated from people that they love due to illness right now. God, we know that you are the healer. You are our comforter, and we pray for that right now. God, we also just want to thank you for how you're moving in our midst, how we as the church are still on the move, even in these crazy, crazy times, God, for how people in our body are coming along, others who need assistance with food or help at their homes or a shoulder to cry on. God, we thank you for how you move through your word, your people, and your Spirit. God, thank you for the evangelism that is happening right now, both because of what's going on and through what's going on. We thank you for Kevin Cochran, who's in Japan right now and feels that call to answer you and go and share the word with those people. God, give him the clarity and the strength to persevere. We thank you for this church and how we've been able to partner with him through that. And God, just now, we just pray that you open our hearts. We pray that you give Matt the words to speak, that you help us to learn what you have for us this morning, to hear from you as we look forward to Christmas and the coming child. We are just so, so grateful and so thankful. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You have a Bible with you, please turn to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17. In just a moment, I'll begin reading at verse 41. Today, we're going to continue working through the book of Samuel. And actually, as we go through 1 and 2 Samuel, we'll be working primarily through the lives of three people. And it's Samuel and Saul and David. And the story today is a very familiar one for most people. So if you have your place, please follow with me as I begin reading 17:41 of 1 Samuel. And the Philistine moved forward and came near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. And the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord saves not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into the forehead, and he fell on his face to the ground. Well, a few weeks ago, I talked about how the book of Samuel opens with one of our favorite types of stories, and it was a love story. But there's another type of story in the book of Samuel right here that is shaped like another one of our favorite types of stories. So we love love stories, but we also love this story where there is somebody who is good who is facing incredible odds. And everything our eyes and ears and mind tells us about the situation and the opponent of this good person, there's no way they can prevail. And then as the story unfolds and they incredibly overcome great odds and prevail, we love that story. The underdog story, the redemptive story, the against all odds stories. I mean, think right now in that category, what's your favorite story? What's your favorite underdog story? Maybe it's this one we're on right now. But it's in all these movies and books and plays we love to immerse ourselves in. Star Wars, Lord of the Rings, you name it. Goes on and on and on. Why do we love this story? There's something about it that's woven deeply into us, that it is universal and across time that this type of story grabs our attention. And it grabs our attention because we know deep down in reality that our fate against the brokenness, the sin, and the death of life, we should not prevail. We cannot prevail. But deep down, we know we were made to prevail. And we know there's somebody moving history and inviting us to move with him towards overcoming impossible odds. That's our story today. But let's review real quick. Last week, the rise and fall of King Saul. I said, for me personally, it's one of the most depressing stories in all of Scripture. I want Saul to succeed, but he doesn't because he's sneaky, he's conniving, he's covert. And what he does on the outside and the words that come out of his mouth are not sincere. And that resonates, unfortunately, too often with my own experience, with my character over my lifetime. One of the key phrases last week, as Samuel is chastising Saul for his failure to obey God, he tells him, obedience is better than sacrifice. And if you remember, sacrifice is the practice of worship. It's what we say we think about God. It's what we put on the outside. But Samuel's reminding us all that our daily obedience really tells what we really think of God. And that our empty worship or our worship that looks good on the outside to the people around us is nothing if internally, daily, we aren't obedient. We aren't walking with God. And Jesus told us in the Gospel of John, if you love me, you will obey me. Don't disobey me all week and then come and give your empty worship, your empty giving. Don't say you love me and then go live relationships the way the world does them, with bitterness and resentment. So we looked at how our worship and our relationships and our giving, we should take stock of how we're doing. And is there obedience woven into all we do? But now we come to, we're past this chastisement and we're coming. And these really are going to be, for the most part, the last words between Saul and Samuel. And Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and your words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. Now, therefore, please pardon my sin and return with me that I may bow before the Lord. So it looks like Saul is repentant But he's had a couple chances. We've seen his character displayed a number of times, and the kingdom has been ripped from him. It's over. And if we read the whole section here with his dialogue with Samuel, we'll find out he's repentant to a point. He's repentant to the point that he wants to be restored again back in front of the people. So even his repentance isn't clean. His place in front of the people is still of primary importance. And Samuel tells him, no, you rejected God. He rejected you. And the intensity of Saul increases. And as Samuel turned to go away, Saul seized the skirt of his robe and tore it. And Samuel said to him, the Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you this day and has given it to a neighbor of yours who is better than you. What a sad scene. So desperate, he grabs the robe, it tears. And it's not just a no, it's a reminder. Somebody else is already getting your spot. He's better than you because he's sincere. And he loves the Lord. He's a man after God's own heart. He thinks like God. He's sincere. And Samuel grieves what happened. God rejects Saul. Samuel has a new task now. The Lord said to Samuel, how long will you grieve over Saul since I have rejected him from being king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons. Well, Samuel, God's moving on. It's time. I've already made my decision. Let's go. Samuel gets this directive, but he's afraid because his break with King Saul was very definitive. And now, if he goes to anoint a new king, the existing king will seek to kill him. God says, here's what you do. Get your stuff. You're going to go to Bethlehem and say you are going to offer sacrifice to the Lord, which he's going to do, and then invite Jesse's family, Jesse and his boys, to be part of this. And so Samuel goes ahead and he does this. And here comes Jesse. Jesse has 8 boys, and there are 7 of them there. And as Samuel's there, and they come in, and he meets them, the first boy to come is Eliab. And Samuel looks at him and goes, obviously, this is the guy. I can tell just looking at him. God redirects Samuel's thinking. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. This is very important. Because you and I, in all kinds of circles in our life, are drawn to make snap judgments about people within a first 1, 2, 3 second viewing. And we're drawn to certain things. We're drawn to strength. We're drawn to power, attractiveness. We're drawn to wealth. We're drawn to fame. And we find ourselves unknowingly, if we could step out of our own life and watch us, I think we would be shocked with how much we favor people based on very superficial attributes. But we can't help ourselves, because that's what we want for ourselves. And Samuel was no different. He's like, obviously, it's the oldest. Look at him. This is it. God said, no. You look for certain attributes, but I look on the heart. You look for tall and attractive, strong, and great presence. I just want somebody who day in and day out communes with me, loves me, and obeys me. So here come all the first seven brothers. God's, nope, nope. Finally, it's like, is there anybody else? Yeah, there's one more. David's an afterthought. So they send for David. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. And Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. And Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. So there it is. The oil is poured. It's a symbol, but in this setting, in this story, the oil is a symbol, but it really, this Holy Spirit is going into David in reality, as the oil is poured. And Scripture tells us, as soon as the Spirit of the Lord goes into David, it says the Spirit of the Lord left Saul, went here. Then the Lord sends a spirit who will harass and torment Saul. And so Saul starts to have these fits of being tormented by this spirit that the Lord has sent for this task. And as Saul gets instruction or advice for help from his court, they surmise correctly that possibly if somebody comes and plays music on a lyre, it will soothe him and take away the torment. So they think this is a good idea. And the person giving advice says, I know somebody, the son of Jesse, the Bethlehemite. And he lists off his character. He had all this great character. And on top of that, he is very gifted with the lyre. So David, at least when there are fits, he's brought in. And God plants his man right in the palace. He's not there all the time, but he's now in there periodically and seeing the comings and goings. And with that set up, the next story is the story of David and Goliath. And we find that the Philistine army has gathered. And they haven't just gathered, they've gathered in the territory of Judah. And this is one of the 12 tribes, and it happens to be the tribe that Jesse and David and the family reside in. And the Philistines have moved onto their lawn. And we find a setting where the army is gathered in one spot, the Philistine army, the Israel army's gathered, and they're kind of at a standoff. Because the largest warrior, Goliath, is taunting Israel. And he stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? And are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves. Let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." So he makes it clear. What? You guys are sitting there. We're the Philistines. We're on your front lawn. Why are you doing nothing? Just send a man down to fight me. Now, visually, if we were there and we look around, as soon as we came, and we know geographically pretty close where this is, as soon as you came into sight of those two spots, you'd look around and you'd see one guy. And you'd say, "Who is that? I would not want to mess with him." And the truth is, nobody did. And so we get Saul and Israel's response. When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now we know from the story, the three oldest sons of Jesse are there. They're part of the military. And this is going to go on for 40 days. And David is going back and forth with supplies and bringing food. And his father keeps sending him and using him to do that. But after 40 days, David hears what Goliath is saying. And he sees the response of Israel, but here's David's response. And David said to the men who stood by him, "What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Whoa. David asks a question that nobody had thought to ask because they weren't prepared to fight. In David's mind, he's already getting ready to fight. And he finds out the king has said the victor gets Saul's daughter, Michal, as a wife, among other things. And this would put the winner into the royal family, a very prestigious leap in their place in the kingdom. While his older brother, Eliab, hears him, and he appears to be very jealous to the point he gets angry at David. And he accuses David of being evil. And have you ever been in a spot where somebody did something responsible that you knew you should have done? And when that happens, maybe we see it and we repent, but most of the time, we feel it, we feel the shame, and we react to cover our shame. And instead of sensing our abdication and owning it, resolving to do better, we get angry, we get jealous. So much of our jealousy is based really on not doing our own responsibility in our own life. So this little interchange happens, and we see what the threat of Goliath is doing to the people. And when David shows up and acts responsibly and virtuous, The contrast is too much for his brother. But word gets to Saul that there is somebody who wants to fight, and David ends up in Saul's company. And at first, Saul's like, you're too young and small. You can't fight. David's like, I'm a shepherd. When a bear or a lion came to attack the sheep, I killed them with my hands. I don't think Saul is really swayed by this, but Saul doesn't have any other options. So he's like, all right, here, you can have my armor because I sure aren't going to use it. Puts it on, too big, too heavy. It's not fit for him. He hasn't trained in it or anything. So David, instead of the armor, he took what he knew. Took his staff in his hand, and he chose 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in his shepherd's pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. Okay. 5 smooth stones. What's going on there? We have to be careful here because sometimes we'll be tempted to allegorize these or make these 5 stones represent certain things. Scripture does not tell us that. What I take from him gathering 5 smooth stones is David is going to move. He does not know what's going to happen, but he's trusting God anyhow. Well, how do I know that? Well, he took 5 stones, and it's only going to take 1 stone. So clearly, David doesn't know exactly what's about to happen. I'll take 5. Puts them in his pouch. Well, as David comes out to face him, here's Goliath's response. The Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. Oh, Goliath, this guy is so scrawny, he's insulted. But notice he curses him by his gods. This isn't David versus Goliath. This is the Philistine gods versus the God. These two people are players. And one knows his position. And he knows his God. Well, David taunts back. You come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. David wants everybody to know who is fighting. And notice the contrast between David and Saul. And Saul, who is so much, and as we go forward after this story, we're going to see that all of Saul's wars and all of his efforts are to bring himself to the forefront. But not David. He just wants everybody to know who his God is. And David makes a promise. This day, the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. We didn't read the part of the whole words of Goliath. But Goliath, after he taunts David, he's insulted by David. He said he's going to give his body to the birds of the air. And so now David takes his taunt, and he's going to use the same taunt right back at you. But Goliath, like most of us, when we're thinking in worldly categories, we like to think and act as if words of great strength actually are going to happen. We act as if just speaking strong is a manifestation of a thing actually happening. But if we're not walking with the Lord, that does not happen. Those words are empty. So Goliath, his use of the taunt turns out to be empty because his gods are empty. But David uses the same taunt and the promise, and it comes true because his God, our God, is true. And David finishes his thought here, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord saves not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand. In this little interchange with Goliath, David makes clear what this battle is about. So sometimes we look at the story and we got David versus the giant, and we're to look for the giants in our life and trust God to defeat them. There may be some application towards something like that, but David himself is telling us what this story is about. The purpose of this battle, by his own words, is twofold. That everybody will know there is a God in Israel. And number two, the Lord saves not with sword or spear. And so when there's a big thing going on in our life and it's huge, yes, God wants us to call on him. But what this story is about is for us to every day in the big and little of life to live as if we truly believe there is a God in Israel. And because he is who he says he is, we know that he saves not with sword and spear. He does not operate the way we traditionally think of worldly power. He works by his own means, the only means effective. He fights a war against evil with love, and he fought it with his own son. And as we look at the story, the story's happening, events are happening, and it's channeling us like a good story does to something we're supposed to see with clarity. Here it is. And so we look at this. Let's take each one of these and look at them. The first, live as if you and I truly believe there's a God in Israel. That shapes our worldview. Now, look at how the Philistines were living. They were living with presumption, pride, and might. Goliath did not believe there was a God in Israel. He believed in his gods, Dagon. How were Saul and the rest of the army of Israel living? They were living in fear and envy. They are not living as if they believe there's a God in Israel. Otherwise, they would have fought. They wouldn't have gone 40 days. And so when you and I turn to things like presumption, pride, fear, envy, our same old behaviors, what we're really doing in our daily life is we're living as if there is no God in Israel. Yes, I believe in God. I call myself a Christian. But I live as if he's not real. He doesn't have power. He doesn't have any request or jurisdiction over all these areas of my life. I give him sacrifice, but not obedience. David, however, lives by faith. He has spiritual vision that gives him a confidence. And he knows there is a God in Israel, and he lives like it. Whether he's tending sheep or whether he's fighting Goliath. For 40 days, he just brought food. But every day, in his heart, what this story is telling us, God knows his heart. And every day, David, tending sheep, lived and tended sheep as if there was a God in Israel. And there was. And there is. So there's a God in Israel, but what else do we know about him from this story that David tells us? He says he doesn't fight with the weapons that we think of. So, number one and number two are dependent. They go together. So if I live as if there is no God in Israel, then my worldview tools will be strength, armor, spears, might, anger, empty words, ambition. And when I get into trouble or I sense situations and I want them to be the way I want them, I wield all these things. And it can be in the workplace. It can just be with our family over the holidays. Here comes that uncle, that parent, that kid again. And I know exactly how they're going to behave. And it's awful. And you're right, they are going to behave like that. But you and I are going to fall into our own devices. And we're going to live and have a holiday like there is no God in Israel. And because of that, we'll fight and manipulate and maneuver the way the world does. However, if I believe there's a God in Israel, the Spirit of the living God is my weapon. He doesn't fight with spears and armor. He fights with love and forgiveness. And that battle that we're to extract from David and Goliath here is fought right here. In our own mind every day. It's the spiritual battle of our mind. There's no greater battle. That's where our Christianity rises and falls. So when I see that person who hurts me repeatedly for years maybe, what do I do with them? Well, I know there's a God in Israel. And I know he doesn't fight the way the world fights. So, if I really believe there's a God in Israel, I must take captive those thoughts in my mind that want me to be like the Philistines and Saul and Eliab. I got to take those captive, stare them in the face, call them out, cut off their head. Moment by moment, hour by hour, day by day. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 10:4-5 says it like this: for the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. This verse, plug it right into what David said. The world needs to know these aren't the weapons that God uses. So what weapons do we as God's people use? Right here. We take every thought captive to obey Christ Because there is a God in Israel. No matter what around us seems to be falling apart in our immediate lives, politically, globally. So we take those three areas I talked about last week, worship, our relationships, and our giving. Are we taking thoughts captive? So in my worship, I have to take thoughts captive beginning usually Saturday night, and then Sunday morning. And even as a pastor and preacher, I have to take thoughts captive so that the Spirit can enter my heart. If I don't do that, He can't enter. I don't want to come lazy and critical and all those things. My relationships. Yes, the same old people do the same old things, but so do I. Do I want to keep that up? How about my giving? Oh, yes. Take that thought captive as soon as it comes into my mind. Hey, that's kind of a lot of money. We could blah, blah, blah. Captivate. Just cut off its head. Let the birds eat it. There is a God in Israel, and I want the world to know it through my life. And that's what we're here for. That's what this story is for. And that's why we exist, to make these same two things known. Well, in just a moment, the worship team's going to come back up, but I want to give us a question for us to wrestle with this week. And also, we'll do a psalm together as a prayer, and then they're going to lead us in a couple more worship songs. What I want us to think about is this. When I take stock of my worship, relationships, giving, and how I handle the difficulties of life, does it reveal that I believe there is a God in Israel? And then take every thought captive. What does that mean in my life? Let's stand together now and read a closing scripture together as a prayer and prepare to worship in song. Follow with me. Know in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
In Luke chapter 1, the angel Gabriel comes to the Virgin Mary and tells about the wonderful birth of our Savior. And he says, His kingdom will have no end. Let's sing to our King. Our God, a firm foundation. Our God, a firm foundation. Our rock, the only solid ground. Nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in Your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of just
Let's bring it all to Him today.
We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in Your name. The name of Jesus. Whoa. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift You higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift You higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, You are victorious.
We lift our banner.
Today. Just like You promised.
you can trust his promise today. Stretch out your hand.
Today is the first Sunday of Advent. We've invited our children to join us today because we want to share this special time of preparation together.
What does Advent mean?
Advent means the arrival of a notable person, thing, or event. We are preparing for Christmas and celebrating the arrival of Jesus.
Jesus is called the Son of David. We are learning about David during our teaching times this month. There are several ways that David points to the coming of Christ. We will be lighting a candle each week as we talk about how David pointed to Christ. The candles stand for shepherd, warrior, deliverer, and king.
Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the season of Advent that helps us prepare for the coming of Christ at Christmas. As we reflect on your word and light a candle, may excitement for Christ's coming burn in our hearts. Amen.
I'm going to give you a hint about today's candle. We see a lot of these at Christmas. Addie, will you take today's clue out of my bag? What is it?
Candy cane.
It's a candy cane, right. What does it remind you of?
Kids, can you guess what it might remind you of?
Think of a shepherd.
Go ahead. A shepherd's hook, staff. That's right.
A shepherd's staff, that's the clue. The candy cane is in the shape of a shepherd's staff. A shepherd uses his staff to take care of sheep. What if I turn it upside down? Now what? A J, I hear you say a J.
J is for Jesus.
That's right. J is for Jesus. Today we're going to light the shepherd candle because Jesus came to be our shepherd.
Can we light our candles?
Yes, let's all light our candles. Maybe. There we go.
When we first met David in the Bible, he is a shepherd. A shepherd has a special love for each of his sheep. In the middle of the darkest night, the shepherd never hesitates to go after and rescue a sheep that is lost, hurt, or in danger.
Sheep are utterly dependent on the shepherd for absolutely every area of their lives. The shepherd serves as protector, physician, provider, leader, and savior from harm. But a shepherd also lays down his life for his sheep to protect them from thieves or wild animals.
People also need help in their lives. That's why people cried out to God to send a Messiah, someone to be our protector, physician, provider, leader, and savior.
David was a shepherd, and Jesus was a shepherd. In the book of 1 Samuel, David said, "When a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth."
In the book of John, Jesus said, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep. I am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep."
Let's stand and read together from Isaiah 40.
A voice cries
in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord.
Make straight in the desert a highway for our God.
Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill made low.
The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain.
And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed.
He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom.
Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you heard our cries and sent Jesus to be our shepherd. We acknowledge that we are utterly dependent on him.
Thank you that he came to be our protector, physician, provider, leader, and savior.
We rejoice that we can celebrate Jesus, our good shepherd, this Christmas.
In his precious name we pray.
Amen.
Come, Emmanuel.
both in one heart and mind. Bid thou our sad division cease, and be thyself our Prince of Peace. Let's rejoice, 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 he may.
Emmanuel, God is with us. Peace to you, my brothers and sisters. And if you're in need of prayer and spiritual help, please reach out to us. Go in peace. You're dismissed.